Hello YouTube, it's the Norwegian artist Knut Andre Vikshåland again. And I was actually going to make a time lapse of an already existing video on my YouTube channel. It's one I made in 2014 and it's about how to paint a yellow rose. It's one of my more popular videos. But then I noticed that the resolution was very poor. And I decided to remake it and post it again. It has a lot of copyrighted material in it, music and stuff like that, so it's gonna be quickly demonetized or it's gonna go to the copyright owners, but that's okay because it's a nice video. So I'll also make a time-lapse version of it soon, but now I'm posting this and I hope you enjoy it. I also like the soundtracks. It's about science and there's good music in it and everything, so hope you enjoy and give it a thumbs up and share it with your friends, and yeah, even become a patron if you want to. There's a link down there at the end of the video and in description. Also find playlists and stuff like that. So until next time, stay cool. Hello YouTube. Today I'm gonna make a paste of a friend of mine called Leandro Cassiano. He's a painter and he makes his own oils and makes it from in the old-fashioned way, and it's quite brilliant. He's almost like a scientist. This oil has been laying in the sun it's made of caramel oil, and it's cleansed with spirits, like 40% Finlandia. It's been lying in the sun for 35 days. And so it becomes more transparent and colorless. It's called sun oil gel. It's quite funny. And he has mixed it with some silicon, powder silicon called, I can't really make it out here what it is. It's called pyretic silica, something like that. Anyway, I'm gonna post a link to his Facebook page so you can ask him himself. What I'm gonna do today is I'm gonna paint this rose, this wild rose. Beautiful roses growing everywhere in Oslo, and I'm gonna paint it on this canvas. It's like 26.26 centimeters wide, and I'm gonna make more like an impressionist painting. I don't really sure if I'm gonna paint more than once on it. I'll see what happens. Maybe I do, maybe I don't. It kind of depends on how long the flower lasts, because these flowers doesn't last long if you cut them from the original plant. Here is the colors. I'm gonna mix this pasty into the colors to see how it will react and how fast it will dry. He is actually using me as a testing tool. He hasn't tested it himself, so it's going to be fascinating to see what happens. Here is more of his oil that he has also cleansed with sand and some seeds. You have to ask him about it. It's too many details, so yeah. I'm gonna also use that a little bit in the same painting, just to cleanse my brushes in between the strokes. Yeah. So what I'm going to do is just take off this. He makes this oil. He presses linen seeds, and from this he makes this oil, and it's quite fascinating. So what I'm doing, I'm just gonna drip some of it on every color, like this. That's the plan anyway. I usually don't work like this. I use ordinary oils and some turpentine, and for mostly I use the color directly from the tube, and just use the turpentine and oil to cleanse my brushes in between the strokes. But the point is that it's more like an intuitive process, so it's not something I I think much about while painting. It's only when I use lazur and like more diluted colors, I use more of it. So what I'm gonna do is just kind of get it into the colors, and after I've done this with all these, I'm gonna put the color on my palette and start painting. So yeah, I'm not gonna do this with the camera on. So yeah, wish me luck, and you will see the rest of the video after this. Okay, thank you for watching. Nice to kind of give something back. I get a lot of nice messages from people that actually learn something from our videos, and it's a nice thing. Okay, thank you, bye bye. Yeah, so here I made a palette, finished. So now I'm just gonna start painting. That is, yeah. Okay. Yeah, P.S. I am extremely interested in science, and since it is a rose, some of the most beautiful things evolution have created, I'm gonna paint today. I'm gonna use one of my favorite documentaries by what's his name? This guy.
Our Earth is the only known planet that sustains life, and it does so in abundance.
Yeah, David Attenborough. Jeez, I could have forget that. It's so beautiful. Anyway, I'm going to use this as a background sound. Usually I do that because I'm listening to a lot of documentaries, lectures and stuff like that while I'm painting, so I can take in some knowledge while doing what I love. And I would recommend it. You don't need to see it. You actually can only need to listen to it over and over and over again, and you will find something new and interesting every time. Anyway, that was basically what I wanted to say. So I guess I'm gonna start painting. I'm not bore you anymore with my peculiar voice. Strange voice. A voice I hate to listen to when I'm hearing myself on videos. Okay, here we go.
A known planet that sustains life, and it does so in abundance. I have been fortunate enough over the years to travel to some of the most extraordinary and remote places on Earth to find and film animals.
This is the biggest flower in the world.
The blue whale! It's the biggest creature that exists on the planet!
The sheer number and variety of animals and plants is astonishing. Estimates of the number of different species vary from 6 million to 100 million.
Nobody knows exactly how many different kinds of animals there are here.
Wherever you look, there's life. There are often a multitude of variations on a single pattern. Nearly 200 different kinds of monkeys, for example. And 315 hummingbirds. Nearly 1,000 bats. And beetles, at least 350,000 species of them. Not to mention a quarter of a million different kinds of flowering plants. The variety is astounding. Even in this one small English woodland, you might see four or five different kinds of finches. Why should there be such a dazzling variety? And how can we make sense of such a huge range of living organisms? 200 years ago, a man was born who was to explain this astonishing diversity of life. In doing so, he revolutionized the way in which we see the world and our place in it. His name was Charles Darwin. This wonderful diversity came about. On the third day after the creation of the world, God created plants. On the fifth day, fish and birds. And then on the sixth day, mammals. And finally, man. That explanation was believed literally by pretty well the whole of Western Europe for the best part of 2,000 years. And generations of painters pictured it for the faithful. This version was painted in Italy in the 16th century. Here is God in the Garden of Eden, which is now filled with all kinds of animals. Here he is pulling Adam out of the earth. And here creating the first woman by putting Adam to sleep and then taking one of his ribs and extracting Eve from his side. And she comes out assisted by two angels. And when God had finished, he said to Adam and Eve, "Be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth." That made it clear that, according to the Bible, humanity could exploit the natural world as they wish. This view of mankind's superiority still stood when, in 1831, a British surveying ship, the Beagle, set off on a voyage around the world. On board, as a companion to the captain, was the 22-year-old Charles Darwin. They crossed the Atlantic and made landfall on the coast of Brazil. There, the sheer abundance of tropical nature astonishes the newcomer, as I discovered when I retraced Darwin's steps 30 years ago for a television series about the diversity of nature. Darwin, as a boy, had been a fanatical collector of insects, and here he was enthralled almost to the point of ecstasy.
In one day, in a small area, he discovered 69 different species of beetle. As he wrote in his journal, "It's enough to disturb the composure of the entomologist's mind to contemplate the future dimension of a complete catalogue."
They went south, rounded Cape Horn, and so reached the Pacific. And then, in September 1835, after they'd been away for almost 4 years, they landed on the little known islands of the Galapagos. Here they found creatures that existed nowhere else in the world, cormorants that had lost the power of flight, lizards that swam out through the surf to graze on the bottom of the sea, Darwin, who had studied botany and geology at Cambridge University, collected specimens of the animals and plants, and as usual when he went ashore to investigate, described what he found in his journal. My servant and self were landed a few miles to the northeast in order that I might examine the district mentioned above as resembling chimneys, organic chimneys presumably. The comparison would have been more exact if I'd sent the iron furnaces near Wolverhampton. The British resident in the Galapagos claimed that he knew from the shape of a giant tortoise's shell which island it had come from. If it had a rounded front, it came from a well-watered island where it fed on lush ground plants. Whereas one from a drier island had a peak at the front, which enabled it to reach up to higher vegetation. Were these tortoises, each on their separate islands, different species? And if so, was each one a separate act of divine creation?
The differences that Darwin had noticed amongst these Galapagos animals were, of course, all tiny. But if they could develop, wasn't it possible that over the thousands or millions of years, a whole series of such differences might add up to one revolutionary change?
On his voyage home, Darwin had time to ponder on these things. Could it be that species were not fixed for all time, but could in fact slowly change? On his return, he sorted out his specimens and sent them off to relevant experts so that each could be identified and classified. Most of the mammal bones and fossils he sent to Richard Owen. Owen was one of the most brilliant zoologists of his time. He was the first to recognize dinosaurs, and indeed had invented their very name. And he would later become the creator and first director of the Natural History Museum in London. Many of the specimens that Darwin collected are still preserved and treasured here, among the 17 million other specimens housed in the museum that Owen founded. And here is one of them. It's obviously the lower jaw of some great animal, and when Darwin discovered it, it had bits of skin and hair attached to it, so that at first it was thought to be the remains of some unknown living species. But now we know that it is a species that was extinct for some 10,000 years, a giant ground sloth. Owen examined it in great detail and eventually described it and gave it the name of Mylodon darwinii in honour of its discoverer. But that mutual respect between two great men of science was not to last. Soon after his return from his voyage, Darwin made his home here in Downhouse in Kent. Here he wrote an account of his travels and worked on detailed scientific treatises about corals and barnacles and the geology and fossils of South America. But he also pondered deeply on what he had seen in the Galapagos and elsewhere. Maybe species were not fixed. He took a walk in this small spinney that he had planted at the end of his garden. And it was here that he came to ponder on the problems of natural history
including that mystery of mysteries, how could one species turn into another? He noted that most, if not all animals, produce many more young than live to breed themselves. This female blue tit, for example, may well lay a dozen eggs a year, perhaps 50 or so in her lifetime. Yet only two of her chicks need to survive and breed themselves to maintain the numbers of the blue tit population. Those survivors, of course, are likely to be the healthiest and best suited to their particular environment. Their characteristics are then inherited, so perhaps over many generations, and particularly if there are environmental changes, species may well change. Only the fittest survive, and that was the key. He called the process natural selection. That would explain the differences that he had noted in the finches that he had brought back from the Galapagos. They were very similar, except for their beaks. This one has a very thin, delicate beak, which it uses to catch insects. This one, on the other hand, which came from an environment where there were a lot of nuts, has a big, heavy beak, which enables it to crack them. So maybe, over the vastness of geological time, and particularly if species were invading new environments, those changes would amount to very radical changes indeed. Darwin drew a sketch in one of his notebooks to illustrate his idea, showing how a single ancestral species might give rise to several different ones, and then wrote above it a tentative, "I think." Now he had to prove his theory, and he spent years gathering abundant and convincing evidence. He was an extraordinary letter writer. He wrote as many as a dozen letters a day to scientists and naturalists all over the world. Started domesticating animals, they had been doing experiments for him for centuries. All domestic dogs are descended from a single ancestral species, the wolf. Dog breeders select those pups that have the characteristics that happen to please them. Nature, of course, selects those young animals that are best suited to a particular environment. But the process is essentially the same, and in both cases, it has produced astonishing variety. In effect, many of these different breeds could be considered different species, because they do not, indeed, they cannot interbreed for purely mechanical reasons. There's no way in which a Pekingese can mate with a Great Dane. Of course, it's true that if you used artificial insemination, you could get crosses between almost any of these breeds. But that's because human beings have been selecting between dogs for only a few centuries. Nature has been selecting between animals for millions of years, tens of millions, even hundreds of millions of years. So what might have started out as we would consider to be breeds have now become so different they are species. House wrote to pigeon fanciers and rabbit breeders, asking all kinds of detailed questions about their methods and results. He himself, being a country gentleman and running an estate, knew about breeding horses and sheep and cattle. And he also conducted careful experiments with plants in his greenhouse. But Darwin knew that the idea that species could appear without divine intervention would appall society in general. And it was also contrary to the beliefs of his wife Emma, who was a devout Christian. Perhaps for that reason, he was keen to keep the focus of his work scientific. He made a point of not being drawn in public about his religious beliefs, but in the latter part of his life, he withdrew from attending church. On Sundays, he would escort Emma and the children here to the parish church in Darwin, but while they went in for service, he remained outside and went for a walk in the country lanes. Perhaps because he feared that his theory would cause outrage in some quarters, he delayed publishing it year after year after year. But he wrote a long abstract of it. And then on July the 5th, 1844, he wrote this letter to his wife. "My dear Emma, I have just finished this sketch of my species theory." Some sketch, it was 240 pages long. "I therefore write this in case of my sudden death, that you will devote £400 to its publication." He then goes on to list his various naturalist friends who would be asked to edit it and check it. And he ends the letter charmingly, "My dear wife, yours affectionately, C.R. Darwin." He continued to accumulate evidence and refine his theory for the next 14 years. But then his hand was forced. In June 1858, 22 years after he got back from the Galapagos, here in his study in Down, he received a package from a naturalist who was working in what is now Indonesia. His name was Alfred Russel Wallace. He had been corresponding with Darwin for some years, but this package was different. It contained an essay that set out exactly the same idea as Darwin's, of evolution by natural selection. The idea had come to Wallace as he lay in his hut, semi-delirious in a malarial fever. But although his idea of natural selection was the same as Darwin's, he had not spent 20 years gathering the mountain of evidence to support it, as Darwin had done. But whose idea was it? In the end, the senior members of the Linnaean Society decided that the fairest thing was for a brief outline of the theory from each of them to be read out one after the other at a meeting of the Society here in Burlington House in London. The Linnaean, then as now, was the place where scientists studying the natural world held regular meetings to present and discuss papers about their observations and thoughts. The one held on July the 1st, 1858, was attended by only about 30 people. Neither of the authors were present. Wallace was 10,000 miles away in the East Indies, and Darwin was ill and devastated by the death a few days earlier of his infant son, so he was still at his home in Kent. As a consequence, the two papers had to be read by the secretary, and as far as we can tell, they made very little impression on anyone. Darwin spent the next year writing out his theory in detail. Then he sent the manuscript to his publisher, John Murray, whose firm, then as now, had offices in Albemarle Street, just off Piccadilly in London. Murray was the great publisher of his day and dealt with the works of Jane Austen and Lord Byron, whose first editions still lie in Neave's office walls. Darwin regarded his work as simply a summary, but even so, it's 400 pages. It was published on November the 24th, 1859. This is not a first edition, more's the pity. First editions are worth literally hundreds of thousands of pounds. This is a sixth edition, my copy, which I bought as a boy, 18 I noticed, and it cost me the princely sum of 1 shilling. The first edition of 1,250 copies sold out immediately, and it went for a reprint. And then another reprint, and another reprint. It's a book that contains very few technical terms. It's easily understood by anybody. And predictably, it caused an outrage, not only throughout this country, but indeed all the civilized world. What scandalized people most, it seems, was the implication that human beings were not specially created by God, as the Book of Genesis stated, but were descended from ape-like ancestors, a notion that provided a lot of scope for cartoonists. The leaders of the church, headed by Samuel Wilberforce, the Bishop of Oxford, attacked it on the grounds that it demoted God and contradicted the story of creation as told by the Bible.
That Mr. Darwin should have wandered from this broad highway of nature's works into the jungle of fanciful assumption is no small evil.
I have read your book with more pain than pleasure.
It is the frenzied inspiration of the inhaler of mephitic gas.
Failed utterly.
Darwin's theory implied that life had originated in simple forms and had then become more and more complex. He knew perfectly well that the whole idea of evolution raised a lot of questions. In fact, some of those questions would not be answered until comparatively recently. But in his own time, many distinguished scientists raised what seemed to be insuperable difficulties. And foremost among them was Richard Owen, the man who 20 years earlier had named the extinct ground sloth in honour of Darwin. Over the years, the two men had developed a deep personal dislike of one another and had quarrelled frequently. It wasn't that Owen thought that the story of the Garden of Eden was literally correct, but nonetheless, he was a deeply religious man. He had, after all, ensured that his museum, which would display the wonders of creation, echoed in its design the great Christian cathedrals of medieval Europe. And Owen knew about the diversity of life. Indeed, he had spent his whole career cataloguing it. But even so, he refused to believe that a species could change over time. He and other pioneer Victorian geologists, as they established their comparatively new science, recognized that the outlines of the history of life could be deduced by examining the land around them.
Look at these rocks in northern Scotland. We know from fossils that are associated with them that they are very ancient. And they are not sandstones. Compacted sand that was laid down at the bottom of the sea, layer upon layer upon layer. But look how many layers there are.
Have been laid down after those beneath them. So as you descend from layer to layer, you are in effect going back in time. So
a fossil species, if it comes from a particular layer, is of a particular age. And if you can recognize each one, then you can begin to piece together the outlines of life's history. My craster. The ability to identify fossils and place them in their geological time zone was still an essential skill when I was at university a century later. We worked our way through drawers like these, which are full of fossils of one sort or another, but none of them have labels, only numbers. So you were expected to be able to pick up one and say, yes, that's a belemnite. Now, actually, which belemnite it is, I can't remember now. And when you came to your practical exam, your examiner would produce one of these and say, okay, what's that? And you either knew or you didn't. And the way you knew was because of all the work you did in drawers like these, hour after hour. Owen did not deny the sequence in which all these different species appeared, but he believed that each was separate, each divinely created. Darwin's theory, however, required that there should be connections, not just between similar species, but between the great animal groups. If fishes and reptiles and birds, mammals, had all evolved from one another, then surely there must be intermediate forms between those great groups. And they were missing. And then, just 2 years after the publication of The Origin of Species, Richard Owen himself purchased the most astonishing fossil for his museum. It had been found in this limestone quarry in Bavaria. The stone here splits into flat, smooth leaves that have been used as roofing tiles since Roman times. Most are black, but occasionally, when you split them apart, they reveal a shrimp or a fish.
It's almost impossible to resist the temptation of pulling down almost every boulder you see and then opening it like a book to look at each unopened page to see whether maybe it contains yet another fossil.
But this fossil was something unprecedented. It is still one of the greatest of the treasures that are stored in the Natural History Museum. And this is it. It's called Archaeopteryx. It has unmistakable feathers on its wings and down its tail. So Owen had no hesitation in calling it a bird, but it was unlike any other bird that anyone knew of, because it had claws on the front of its wings, and as was later discovered, it didn't have a beak, but jaws with teeth in it, and a line of bones supporting its tail. So it was part reptile, part bird. Here was a link between those two great groups that was no longer missing. Gosh, you really can see the filaments there. Other examples of the same creature show its feathers even more clearly. We know from the bones of Archaeopteryx that it was, at best, a very poor flyer. So it's not surprising that eventually it was superseded by more modern, more efficient birds. And that's the fate of these links between great groups. Eventually, they become extinct, and the only way we know they existed is from their fossilized remains. Even so, there is a bird alive today that illustrates the link between modern birds and reptiles. The hermitsyn nests in the swamps of tropical South America. There are caiman in the water beneath, ready to snap up any chick that might fall from its nest, so an ability to hold on tight is very valuable.
and the nestlings have a very interesting way of doing that. The young still have claws on the front of their wings, as Archaeopteryx did. Here is vivid evidence that the wings of birds are modified forelegs and once had toes with claws on them. There's another creature alive today that represents a link between the great animal groups, a descendant of a group of reptiles that took a different evolutionary course and evolved not feathers, but fur. The platypus.
When specimens of this creature first reached Europe from Australia at the very end of the 18th century, people refused to believe their eyes. They said it was a hoax. Bits and pieces of different creatures, rather crudely sewn together. And yet, in a way, those early skeptics were right. The platypus is the most extraordinary mixture of different animals. It's part mammal and part reptile. And so it can give us some idea of how the first mammals developed. When it comes to brood, it does something that separates it from all other mammals except one. In its nest, deep in a burrow, it lays eggs. It's this that links the platypus with the reptiles, and this that entitles it to be regarded as the most primitive living mammal.
So, the links between the great animal groups are not, in fact, missing, but exist both as fossils and as living animals. Although the fossil record provides an answer to the problem of missing links, it also posed a major problem. It started very abruptly. The earliest known fossils in Darwin's time came from a formation called the Cambrian. And there were two main kinds. These, which look like pretzel blades and are called graptolite, and these, like giant woodlice, which are called trilobites. Could it really be that life on Earth started with creatures as complex as these? As a boy, I was a passionate collector of fossils. I grew up in the city of Leicester, and I knew that in this area, not far from the city, called Charlwood Forest, there were the oldest rocks in the world, older even than the Cambrian. So therefore, by definition, they would be without fossils. There was no point in me looking for fossils in these ancient rocks. There were, it's true, very rarely, some rather odd shapes in these rocks, like this one here. But they were dismissed as being some kind of mechanical aberration. I mean, after all, how could there be anything living in these extremely ancient rocks? And then, in 1957, a schoolboy with rather more patience and perspicacity than I had, found something really remarkable and undeniably the remains of a living creature. And here it is in Leicester Museum, where it's been brought for safekeeping. It's called Charnia. Who could doubt that this is the impression of a living organism? It has a central stem, branches on either side. In fact, it seems to have been something like the sea pens that today grow on coral reefs. Since its discovery, a whole range of organisms have been found in rocks of this extreme age, not only here in the Charlwood Forest, but in many other different parts of the world. Fossil hunters searching these rocks in the Ediacara Hills of Australia had also been discovering other strange shapes.
At first, many scientists refused to believe that these faint impressions were the remains of jellyfish.
But by now, enough specimens have been discovered to make quite sure that that indeed is what they are.
So now we know that life did not begin suddenly with those complex animals of the Cambrian. It started much, much earlier, first with simple microscopic forms which eventually became bigger, but which were still so soft and delicate that they only very rarely left any mark in the rocks. The question of the age of the Earth posed another problem for Darwin's theory. In the 17th century, an Irish bishop had used the genealogies recorded in the Bible that lead back to Adam to work out that the week of creation must have taken place in the year 4004 BC. That may seem to us to be a very naive way of doing things, but what other method was there anyway? The Victorian geologists had already concluded that the Earth must be millions of years old, but how many millions, no one could say. Then, less than 50 years after the publication of The Origin, a discovery was made in what seemed a totally disconnected branch of science that would ultimately provide the answer. A Polish woman working in Paris, Marie Curie, discovered that some rocks contained an element called uranium that decays over time at a steady rate through a process called radiation. Today, a century after she made her extraordinary discovery, the method of dating by measuring changes in radioactivity has become greatly refined. This is a sample taken from those very ancient rocks in Charnwood Forest. And these tiny crystals are revealed to be 562 million years old. That provides more than enough time for natural selection to produce the procession of fossils that eventually leads to the living animals and plants we know today. But there was another objection. If all animals within a group have a common origin, how is it that some kinds of animals are distributed throughout the continents of the world except for Antarctica? How is it that, for example, frogs in Europe and Africa are also found here in South America on the other side of the Atlantic Ocean, bearing in mind that frogs have permeable skins and can't survive in seawater? Darwin himself had a couple of suggestions. One was that they might have floated across accidentally on rafts of vegetation, and the other is that maybe there were land bridges between the continents. But even he was not convinced by either explanation. Even as late as 1947, when I was a geology student here at Cambridge, there was no convincing explanation. It's true that back in 1912, a German geologist had suggested that at one time in the very remote distant part today, were grouped together to form one huge supercontinent, and that over time this broke up and the pieces drifted apart. That would have provided an answer. But when I asked the professor of geology here, who was lecturing to us, why he didn't tell us about that in his lectures, he replied, "Up and the pieces drifted apart." That would have provided an answer. But when I asked, rather loftily I must say, when you can demonstrate to me that there is a force on Earth that can move the continents by a millimetre, I will consider it. But until then, the idea is sheer moonshine, dear boy. But then, in the 1960s, it became possible to map the sea floor in detail. And it was discovered not only that the continents have shifted in just the way that the German geologists had suggested, but that they were still moving. New rock wells up from deep below the Earth's crust and flows away on either side of the mid-ocean ridges, carrying the continents with it.
Amphibians had originally evolved on this supercontinent and had then travelled on each of its various fragments as they drifted apart. Problem solved.
Perhaps the biggest problem of all for most people was the argument put forward for the existence of God at the beginning of the 19th century by an Anglican clergyman called William Paley. He said, supposing you were walking in the countryside and you picked up something like this, you would know from looking at it that it had been designed to tell the time. There must, therefore, be a designer. And the same argument would apply if you looked at one of the intricate structures found in nature, such as the human eye. And the only designer of the human eye could be God. Anti-evolutionists maintain that the eye would only work if it was complete in all its details. Darwin, on the other hand, argued that the eye had developed, becoming increasingly complex over a long period of time. That would only work if each stage of development was an improvement on the previous one. And today we know enough about the animal kingdom to know that that is indeed the case. Some very simple animals have nothing more than light-sensitive spots that enable them to tell the difference between light and dark. But if a patch of some spots formed even the shallowest of pits, one edge of the pit would throw a shadow and so reveal the direction of light. If the pit got deeper and started to close, then light would form a blurred image. Mucus secreted by the cells would bend the light and focus it. If this mucus hardened, it would form a proper lens and transmit a brighter and clearer image. All these different fully functional stages at different levels of complexity are found in living animals today. This single-celled creature has one of those light-sensitive spots. Flatworms have a small pit containing light spots, so they can detect the shadow of a predator. A snail's blurry vision is good enough to enable it to find its way to food. And the octopus has an eye with a proper lens and can see as much detail as we can. So the structure of the human eye does not demand the assistance of a supernatural designer. It can have evolved gradually, with each stage bringing a real advantage, as Darwin's theory demands. Natural selection, of course, requires that an animal's characteristics are handed from one generation to the next. It's obvious that children resemble their parents. Anyone knows that. But when you come to think of it, how does that come about? In Darwin's time, nobody had the faintest idea about the mechanism or the rules that govern that process. Except perhaps for one man, who was working in the city of Brno, in what is now the Czech Republic, at exactly the same time that Darwin was writing his book in Kent. That man's name was Gregor Mendel. He discovered the laws of inheritance by breeding thousands of pea plants and observing how they changed from one generation to the next. He found that while many characteristics were passed down directly from one generation to another, others could actually skip a generation. How could that happen? Mendel explained this by suggesting that each plant, each organism, contained within it factors which were responsible for creating those particular characteristics. Today, we call those things genes. But nobody had any idea how they worked until 100 years after Mendel's time. And then the answer was discovered in Cambridge. In 1953, here in the Cavendish Laboratories, two young researchers, Francis Crick and James Watson, were building models like this. It was their way of thinking about and investigating the structure of a complex molecule that's found in the genes of all animals, DNA. The crucial bit are these chains which encircle the rod. And here is a second, and entwine. This is the double helix. The workings of the DNA molecule are now understood in such detail that we can demonstrate something that is truly astounding. A gene taken from one animal can function in another. The gene that causes a jellyfish to be luminous, for example, transplanted into a mouse, will make that mouse luminous. The genetic code can also reveal relationships. Even our law courts accept that DNA fingerprinting can establish whether a man is the father of a particular child. And it can also reveal whether one kind of animal is related to another. It proves, for example, that kangaroos, ground-living animals that run with great leaps, are closely related to koalas that have taken to climbing trees. That insect-eating shrews have cousins that took to the air in search of insects, bats. And that one branch of the elephant family, way back in geological history, took to the water and became sea cows. So, 150 years after the publication of Darwin's revolutionary book, modern genetics has confirmed its fundamental truth. All life is related. And it enables us to construct with confidence the complex tree that represents the history of life. It began in the sea some 3,000 million years ago. Complex chemical molecules began to clump together to form microscopic blobs, cells. These were the seeds from which the tree of life developed. They were able to split, replicating themselves as bacteria do. And as time passed, they diversified into different groups. Some remained attached to one another so that they formed chains. We know them today as algae. Others formed hollow balls which collapsed upon themselves, creating a body with an internal cavity. They were the first multicelled organisms. Sponges are their direct descendants. As more variations appeared, the tree of life grew and became more diverse. Some organisms became more mobile and developed a mouth that opened into a gut. Others had bodies stiffened by an internal rod. They, understandably, developed sense organs around their front end. A related group had bodies that were divided into segments with little projections on either side that helped them to move around on the sea floor. Some of these segmented creatures developed hard protective skins which gave their bodies some rigidity. So now the seas were filled with a great variety of animals. And then around 450 million years ago, some of these armored creatures crawled up out of the water and ventured onto land. And here, the tree of life branched into a multitude of different species that exploited this new environment in all kinds of ways. One group of them developed elongated flaps on their backs, which over many generations eventually developed into wings. The insects had arrived. Life moved into the air and diversified into myriad forms. Meanwhile, back in the seas, those creatures with a stiffening rod in their bodies had strengthened it by encasing it in bone. A skull developed, with a hinged jaw that could grab and hold on to prey. They grew bigger and developed fins equipped with muscles that enabled them to swim with speed and power. So fish now dominated the waters of the world. One group of them developed the ability to gulp air from the water surface. Their fleshy fins became weight-supporting legs, and 375 million years ago, a few of these backbone creatures followed the insects onto the land. They were amphibians with wet skins, and they had to return to water to lay their eggs. But some of their descendants evolved dry, scaly skins and broke their link with water by laying eggs with watertight shells. These creatures, the reptiles, were the ancestors of today's tortoises, snakes, lizards, and crocodiles. And of course, they included the group that, back then, came to dominate the land, the dinosaurs. But 65 million years ago, a great disaster overtook the Earth. Whatever its cause, a great proportion of animals were exterminated. All the dinosaurs disappeared except for one branch, whose scales had become modified into feathers. They were the birds. While they spread through the skies, a small, seemingly insignificant group of survivors began to increase in numbers on the ground beneath. These creatures differed from their competitors in that their bodies were warm and insulated with coats of fur. They were the first mammals. With much of the land left vacant after the great catastrophe, they now had their chance. Their warm, insulated bodies enabled them to be active at all times, at night, as well as during the day, and in all places, from the Arctic to the tropics, in water, as well as on land, on grassy plains, and up in the trees.
Chimpanzees and the rest of the apes and monkeys, as say, lions are to tigers and to the rest of the cat family. When our distant ancestors, in order to keep up with the changing environment, had to wade and keep their heads above water in order to find food. At that crucial moment, when our far distant ancestors took a step away from being apes and a step towards humanity. The Natural History Museum is one of the most important museums of its kind in the world. Richard Owen brought it into existence
but over a century later, discoveries from many branches of science have shown that his belief that species can never change but always remain exactly the same was mistaken. Darwin's profound insights that have proved to be true. And now, to mark the 200th anniversary of his birth, his statue is being taken from its out-of-the-way location to be placed centre stage in the main hall. Darwin's great insight revolutionized the way in which we see the world. We now understand why there are so many different species, why they are distributed in the way they are around the world, and why their bodies and our bodies are shaped in the way that they are. Because we understand that bacteria evolve, we can devise methods of dealing with the diseases they cause. And because we can disentangle the complex relationships between animals and plants in a natural community, we can foresee some of the consequences when we start to interfere with those communities. But above all, Darwin has shown us that we are not apart from the natural world. We do not have dominion over it. We are subject to its laws and processes, as are all other animals on Earth, to which indeed we are related.
Poster, and to find out more about Charles Darwin and Open University programs on the BBC, call 0845 300 88 54 or go to bbc.co.uk/Darwin.
And if you'd like to know more about our Darwin season, the related TV and radio programs, and so much more, go to bbc.co.uk/Darwin and enjoy. Tonight, David Walliams gives a startling performance as Frankie Howard in Rather
Tall Men.
And have you at any time had any religious faith?
No.
The anteater couldn't have existed before the ants. So unless the whole complex was brought into existence in one flash of instant creation, different organisms must have appeared at different times. But which came first, and why should there be such an immense variety? Such questions obsessed a young 24-year-old Englishman who came to these forests in 1832. His name was Charles Darwin, and he was enthralled almost to the point of ecstasy by the richness of life that he found here. In one day, in a small area, he discovered 69 different species of beetle. As he wrote in his journal, it's enough to disturb the composure of the entomologist's mind to contemplate the future dimension of a complete catalogue. The conventional view of the time was that each and every species of animal and plant had been individually created by God. And Darwin was no atheist.
Your programmes clearly are Darwinist, but it's not something you never seem to actually take on the creationist who, for example...
I certainly do privately, and would quite happy to do. It's not the place to do it in the sort of programmes I make. I have a very vigorous correspondence with a number of religious fundamentalists, and I have a pretty straightforward answer, really, which is that all societies, have had need to find an explanation of the way in which human beings came into the world. And the Australian Aboriginals think it's a rainbow serpent in the sky, and the Thais think that it's a sea of milk being churned by demons, and that a tribe of people in the Middle East thought that it was a garden in which the first woman was made by taking a rib from Adam. Now, they can't all be right. Some of them has to be wrong. So which are right? Well, the only, in face with such conflict, why don't we look at the world around us, as in this institution, and try and make sense of that? Because this evidence is the same everywhere. You know? And I find it far more awesome, wonderful, that it should have, that creation, our appearance in the world, should be the culmination, or at least the one of the latest products of 3,000 million years of organic evolution, than a kind of conjuring trick from taking a rib out of a man's side in a trance.
But the word wonder is important because you know, because you get letters from creationists, I'd imagine, particularly you watch Radio in America. A lot of people take that leap from a sense of wonder in nature to assuming there must be something behind it. When you look and you clearly have that sense of wonder, that sense of awe of the natural world, you are thinking, what, this just, it just happened, it's just...
I don't know. I can't believe that it, each species was brought into existence by a merciful God who cares about human beings, for obvious reasons. I mean, for the fact that why is there so much pain, why is there so much disaster, why are some animals tortured in so many ways, why are human beings tortured by all kinds of parasites? I can't believe that God created parasites in order to torture small children.
The question then arises, in human history, a lot of people have behaved well because they believed that God wanted them to, or they would suffer if they didn't. You are clearly, reading about you, having talked to you before, someone who believes that we should try and behave well to others, live well and so on. You would do that because we simply should. It's our obligation to other human beings.
Yes. I suppose, I mean, do as you would be done by is a fairly basic and hardly sophisticated proposition, but there's nonetheless some truth in it. I feel a kind of morality. I feel there's a man has moral obligation to not only to his own kind, but actually to the world at large, to the natural world at large. I think there are lots of very good practical reasons why we should conserve the natural world. You can talk about research for drugs, or wanting to get the right things for food, or all kinds of practical reasons. But ultimately, the reason for survival is a moral one.
What sort of animals do you have an emotional response to? What gets your heart racing?
Emotionally, not many, but emotionally in the sense of affection. But what sets my heart racing is when I see moments of splendour and of life, of sheer resurgence of life. When you see, well, I can remember very well in up in Arnhem once, when I was up there, 40, 50 years ago, when there were very few people up there, and certainly very few strangers. And I remember building a hide by a lagoon, a billabong, and seeing it absolutely thronged with magpie geese and egrets and crocodiles and wallabies and rubbish. And on those moments, you are divorced from the natural world. You are seeing something in which you play no part. It's nothing to do with you, but it's going on out there. Boy, is it going on. You're absolutely full of zest and life. And it's going on out there, and it happened before you were conceived, and it happened long since after you've gone.
You bridle at being called an animal lover. Why is that?
Well, because when people say animal lover, it normally means that you have a little pet dog with ribbons in its hair and you keep it on your lap and you lick its face and the oil and then it licks your face. That is not my game. Do I love an earthworm? No, I do not love an earthworm, but I think an earthworm is a very interesting thing. So I'm interested in animals. I would like to think that I have a scientific interest in animals. And I am fond of many animals in a rather irrational, emotional way, in which you can be of pets, or indeed of other creatures which people are not normally keep as pets. But I just bridle a little at the word animal lover, because that can be twisted to mean that you're using animals as a substitute for human beings.
As you said, people have a romantic view of animals, or they want to have a romantic view of it. Is part of the attraction for you, is it the purity, and sometimes the violence? Is that part of the marvel?
Oh, it's certainly part of the marvel. It becomes, when you're watching, if you watch a lion take a young wildebeest calf, you would be inhuman if you didn't feel deep pity for the pain of this small creature, which is being eaten alive. I mean, quite literally having its guts ripped out of it. And if you didn't see the distress of the mother, of course those things are going on. And it is part of your humanity that you feel the pain and the tragedy. But it's a pain and tragedy that stems from you rather than it does from them. You know perfectly well, I mean, people write and say, why didn't you go out and shoo off the lion? Well, shooing off lion's not my game anyway, but I mean, even if it were, you would only make the matter worse, because the lion has got to feed, or it's got to feed its cubs, or whatever, and the little thing is probably too badly wounded, and so never going to recover, so there's nothing you can do about it. And so you have to accept this, that it is part of this pattern.
Why does music mean so much to you?
It's a mystery. It's a mystery, isn't it? And I often think about it as a biologist. I once made a film, a program about music and animals, because music, of course, it depends how you define it, but you can produce a definition which includes other species apart from themselves that make music, and whales or birds or gibbons. I mean, they produce long sequences of sound which are very often individual and which are modified but repeatable, and which has an effect on others. And so what does it do in the animal kingdom? Well, it cements society. But it also makes declarations about your emotional state. And at the simple level, a whale calling is saying, one, this is me, and two, I could be calling for a female. Certainly that's what a bird says in certain senses, as well as saying, other males, get out of my way. So that's very low level stuff. But human beings have taken this particular thing, which I'm absolutely convinced came to us before language. Music is before language. We were beating on stalactites and we were using drums and drumming on things, just the same way as chimpanzees are drumming on trees to signal to one another, which they undoubtedly do. We were doing that before we were speaking in any degree. And it's very eloquent, this particular thing. So when you get great minds can express themselves in music.
After all, trivial minds can do so too, but when great minds do it, when Johann Sebastian Bach does it, the effect is overwhelming, as far as I can say. Because he is able to speak and communicate not only to his own people, but across the centuries in an extraordinary way.
When you were young, you saw a Polish concert pianist entertaining Polish refugees during World War II.
I remember it very well, very, very well. And I remember his name, Krzysztof. During the war, there were Polish airmen stationed around Dresden, where I lived. Very brave people who lost their homeland. And it so happened that quite close to where I lived, there was the best concert hall, such as it was, not very good, but it was the best in the Midlands. And this Polish pianist appeared, his name was Krzysztof, and he was going to play Chopin. And I'd been setting program. And then he played a Polonaise. And there was a man, he wasn't even sitting down, he was standing at the back, a grey-haired man, I remember, rather long grey hair. And tears appeared in his eyes and trickled down his cheeks. And of course, he must have been a Polish refugee. And his face didn't move apart from that. I mean, it just, tears coursed down his cheeks. I'd never seen an adult cry before. And I was absolutely astounded that this was happening. And I suppose I must have realised that music meant something in terms of communication. It was communicating to that guy in the most profound way.
Have you experienced that with music?
Yes. Yes. Although I think I am not very demonstrative.
So what was the music that reached you?
Oh, Bach nearly always. Bach nearly always. If I really was talking about profundity. But Bach, which is about mercy, and which is about love, and I don't mean ecstatic sexual love, I mean a profound love of humanity and a vision of the infinite. And now what that means, I have no idea. But I can't think of any other words to use to explain. Many a Bach cantata.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
So, I'm almost finishing my wild rose, which became more difficult than I thought. But with the help of Leandro's oil, it was a good experience. His oil and paste enabled me to put layer upon layer upon layer instead of have to wait for it to dry. So it was a good experience. Now it's always difficult to know when to stop. That has always been one of my biggest problems, because I can't really decide what is good or bad, or yeah, basically when to stop. I have decided to stop now, actually, soon. Well, anyway, I'm gonna stop now and post a video of this, and I hope you may learn something from it. So, now, I think it became not so bad. The problem is wild rose dies very fast, so it's kind of hard to finish it in time. Well, anyway, you've seen it now, so, and here am I. Well, anyway, thank you for watching. Yay, there we are. I guess you saw this video until the end. And I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you also can press the Patreon button or the subscription button, or you can go watch some of my other videos. And if you become a patron, there is a monthly giveaway painting, something like the one you saw me paint now. And for $5 you can actually become an owner of that. If you want to support me with $1, that is also great, and I will put you in that giveaway lottery every time you reach $5. So with this, I beg you a fine farewell. Until next time, stay cool and keep watching and keep giving thumbs up and leave comments and all that stuff. So yay.